Now, architecture of this presentation is why dizziness and vertigo is to be taken up seriously, and that too at ACP. Why is dizziness and its broader subsets, what is dizziness and its broader subsets including vertigo? What is vertigo, the true medical vertigo? The next will be how vertigo is different from presyncope and syncope. Then there will be common disorders of vertigo, the peripheral ones and the central ones. Then there will be common misconceptions about vertigo. Then there will be approach, the main topic, how to approach a case of vertigo, keeping in mind the life-threatening ones. Due to time constraints, various maneuvers and tests, they have been deleted from this talk, because this talk is meant for, I think, about 15 minutes. Why dizziness and vertigo is to be taken up very seriously? Because it's a clinical presentation. It can present to a physician, to a pain MBBS, to ENT surgeon, to neurologist, neurosurgeon, ENT surgeon, ops and gyne, surgery people, anybody. Number one. Number two, it has got myriad of manifestations. Myriad of manifestations. Koi kehta hai humko chakkar aa raha hai, lightheadedness, generalized weakness, pre-syncope, syncope, sometimes even seizures. Number three, often, of course, this has been covered, often it is confused with the generalized weakness, giddiness, lightheadedness, pre-syncope, etc. Number three and number four, it is a very common presenting feature in OPD, constituting about 20% in all the disease structure. And sometimes patient, but majority of the times, patient him or herself may not be able to tell exactly what they mean by vertigo and allied symptoms of dizziness. And for a clinician also, many a times, including myself, I am emphasizing, including myself, it becomes difficult to exactly pinpoint what patient means by telling dizziness or vertigo. Now, what is dizziness? Dizziness is an imprecise, non-specific symptom which is used to describe many common variable sensations as vertigo, the true vertigo itself, lightheadedness, faintness, imbalance, going to fall, and lot of vernacular language words. Dizziness is not always vertigo. I am repeating, dizziness is not always vertigo. Rather, vertigo is a definite sensation which comes under the wider domain of dizziness. The broader domain of dizziness. Dizziness can be divided into a cluster of three major subsets. First is vestibular dizziness with imbalance, with or without imbalance. This is true vertigo. Harrison says, if it is V for vertigo, then it has to be V for vestibular or its connection. Then presyncopal dizziness, all the causes of syncope and presyncope. They can be cardiac arrhythmias, valvular, CMP, etc. Then postural hypotension. The neural causes like vasovagal, cough syncope, micturition syncope, fright, extreme anxiety, fear, medication effects, etc. Then dizziness can be due to non-vestibular lesions like non-presyncopal dizziness, like in imbalance disorders, Parkinsonism, sensory ataxias, and in severe anxiety. So this was about dizziness, not vertigo. What is vertigo in a true medical sense? Because we all know, we all get daily bombardment. Sir, humko vertigo hai, humko chakkar aa raha hai. But what is true vertigo? If we know what true vertigo is, then our 50% job is done. It's a sense of spinning or other motion that occurs during or after a sustained head rotation. It may have illusion of self-spinning or outer environment, side to side or forward and backward. Now I am going to show how we can produce physiological vertigo in our cells. Because if I know the sensation of vertigo, then only I will be able to delineate from the patient. Sir, please give me 3 seconds, 4 seconds to show me how to produce physiological vertigo. Just keep like this. No, this sensation which you get, this sensation which you get is vertigo. And if it is vertigo, it is vestibular or its connection. Talk is over. If this sensation, any movement, your movement, environmental movement, forward, backward, falling down, whatever. But this sensation, if this sensation is there, it is vertigo. And if it is vertigo, then it has to be vestibular or its connection. Talk is over. Now we are going forward. So vertigo can be physiological, which I showed, and it can be pathological. And according to our Gita, our Quran, our Bible, Harrison's, if vertigo is there, it has to be vestibular or its connection. Thank you, sir. Next. Vestibular dysfunctions, the vertigo can be divided into peripheral disorders and central disorders. Peripheral disorders means affecting labyrinth or vestibular nerves, and then there are central disorders which may result from any disruption of central vestibular pathways to the cerebrum, to the cerebellar tract, to cerebellum, or to the spinal cord, or to the basal ganglia, anywhere, any central connection. Now this is my own diagram. I have just shown that first is, this is all dizziness. BP high, low, heart rate high, low, sodium high, low, glucose high, low, hormones high, low, temperature high, low, output, cardiac output high, low, hemoglobin low, plasma low. This is all giddiness. But if there is vertigo, it has to be from this reason. Nothing can be from these. You cannot say that this is vertigo. The vertigo is this. Then again, some for academic purpose, psychogenic vertigo, central causes, cerebellar causes, then craniovertebral junction, Arnold Chiari malformation, then all these peripheral causes. Again, a vestibular nuclei. So if a patient has got vertigo, then it has to be from these connections, nothing outside. Now, it is almost always customary to differentiate between vertigo and syncope. In our MD days, I asked one of my senior physician, Professor Rasarga, sir, why there should be any confusion? Because vertigo, it's a positive heightened sensation of spinning and imbalance. Positive heightened sensation of spinning and imbalance, while in syncope, it's in fact a type of negative sensation, loss of consciousness. It may be associated with nystagmus, where the nystagmus is not there. And in vertigo, patient himself explains, oh, hame chakkar aa raha tha. He will explain. While in syncope, he will say, oh, I don't remember what happened to me, or relatives will tell you. So there shouldn't be any confusion just by 1.5 minute talk to your patient. Some crisp examination and test must be done for any vertigo. These are general examination, gait, neuromuscular loss, ear examination, nystagmus, checking the eye movement and head thrust test and few more, which is out of domain of this 15 minute topic. Now true vertigo. Now before going to the approach, I am enumerating some true vertigo causes like vestibular neuritis. We all know it is a very common thing with presents with nausea, vomiting, oscillopsia, and it may run from few minutes to few hours up to days. Then there is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. It is provoked by change in head position. This is very important. It is provoked by change in head positions relative to gravity, as lying down, getting up, extending the neck up or down, getting neck down, and rolling over on the bed. So paroxysmal, this BPPV is, all these maneuvers, they are diagnostic of BPPV. With migraine, yes. Some of the migraines, they turn into vestibular migraine. Or migraine per se can have vertigo. Or some of the migraine, it can be a variant of migraine where there is only vertigo and there is very less component of headache or vomiting. So it's another entity within the migraine. Then clinically with hearing loss, Meniere's disease, we all know. There will be tinnitus, there will be auditory loss, and there will be repeated vertigo starting from 1 year, unilateral. And later it can become bilateral. Then there are vestibular schwannomas. Now here, there is a catch. This has been added just because of academic interest. Because vestibular schwannomas or CP angle tumors, classically, they do not present as vertigo. Vertigo is a minor symptom. Classically, they present as progressive sensory neural deafness. Then come the central vestibular disorders, long list. Then they can be acute, subacute or chronic, but they are very important if they are acute. All the vascular causes, ischemia, hemorrhage, infections, then subacute to chronic, like immunological processes, paraneoplastic processes, neurodegenerative disorders, and tumors. Then comes the psychosomatic and functional disorders. They should be, their diagnosis should be made, of course, after exclusion. And it has been written that severe depression, major depression, and severe anxiety or panic disorders, they may produce a true vertigo. And sometimes the fright and fear of having vertigo also develops vertigo. These were the common disorders which present as vertigo. A common misconception about vertigo. Patient come to your clinic, he has got this cervical collar. Oh, kya ho gaya? What happened to you? Sir, I have got severe vertigo. Oh, okay. Then, sir, this is due to cervical spondylosis. My professor, Professor Devika Nag, neurologist, she used to fail any MD or DM candidate if ever he came out with cervical spondylosis as the cause of vertigo. If at all cervical spondylosis is going to produce vertigo, it has to be very extreme, and by that time he will be having quadriplegia, pains. He will not come to you with vertigo because there will be severe destruction, vertebral artery being impinged upon the bones and then producing vertebrobacillar insufficiency and vertigo. So in general, cervical spondylosis is not the cause of vertigo. For the approach, some common observations must be sought. Is it pure vertigo or have other features, central connection features? Is it acute, subacute, recurrent or chronic? Is it first or repeat? And if repeated, then how often? Is it unilateral, bilateral or asymmetrical? Now, approach to a case of vertigo. Approach in any medical case is always life first. Avoiding mortality, saving the man, saving the woman, it is the first priority. So first, we should attend the life-threatening situation and then reducing the morbidity and complete recovery and rehabilitation should be the aim. A case of vertigo, a short duration comes. First is to delineate it from dizziness. Then first confirm clinically, is it true? If it is true, then rule out head injury and trauma, and then rule out about the vestibular toxic drugs like aminoglycosides. Now, acute vertigo with acute additional central neurological signs and symptoms like central signs like diplopia, dysarthria, dysphagia, ataxia, numbness, variable motor weakness, facial deviation, altered sensorium. You must get MRI done to rule out potentially life-threatening situations of cerebrovascular lesions, hemorrhage, infarctions, etc. So that you have diagnosed a vascular insult and managed accordingly. Now, second scenario, acute vertigo, but no central cause. As I have already enumerated, acute vestibular neuritis, it is acute, repeated, recurrent type of presentation. Then it can be BPPV, as I have already talked. Then there can be vestibular migraine, then Meniere's disease, and then vestibular schwannomas. Now, about if it is subacute to chronic progressive central vertigo or vestibular hypofunction, note, their presentation is not predominantly vertigo. They may be, number one, neurodegenerative disorders like Parkinsonism associated with Parkinsonism or subacute neurodegenerative disorders. Disorders due to immune as well as paraneoplastic syndromes. Then there can be multisystem atrophy. Then there can be gait disorders, sensory ataxias, SACTs, etc. The conclusion and take-home message. Not all dizziness is vertigo. Vertigo is a definite sensation of illusionary relative movement within the subset, within dizziness. One must distinguish it from presyncope. It may be due to some very benign disease, or it may be a life-threatening situation. Physicians themselves must know how it feels to have vertigo. They must get a spinning test on themselves. In any acute setting, one must rule out the life-threatening situation by clinical as well as radiological tests. Other than acute central vertigo, which can be life-threatening, all other cases give ample time to clinicians to make a proper diagnosis. And last but not the least, even in benign disease, it is our duty and our attendant's duty and subject duty to prevent fall and trauma. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.